We could not find a solution of our saturation profile in the usual sense. Nice and differentiable everywhere. We need to generalize and look for weak solutions. Those may consist of rarefaction waves, constant states, and shocks. But if you want to connect our injection condition, water saturation 1, to our initial state, Conant water, we will need at least one shock. Only rarefaction waves and constant states will not do. But where is our shock? Can we place it anywhere? Now, shock saturation and shock speed are determined via two physical principles. The first is mass conservation across the shock. This leads to the Rankine-Hogonio condition that gives the shock speed in terms of the saturations. We will encounter the Rankine-Hogonio condition in this video. Combined with the second condition, the entropy condition, we will also find shock saturations. This second condition is subject of the next video. Now let us start with the Rankine-Hogonio condition. Because here we have our profile if you have just a rarefaction wave, but where do we shock? Like, do we shock like this to the injection state, or do we go a bit further with rarefaction and shock here, or do we go a bit further and shock here? So there are many ways to go from the rarefaction wave initially to the initial state. So what was our problem? Conservation law for SW. UW equals U inject, which is constant times FW, which is given in terms of SW. We use the similarity transformation eta equals x over t to find our rarefaction wave. So that's the first part over there. And then we need to find the position where we shock from the rarefaction wave, boom, towards, well, for example, the SWC, the initial state. Now let us look at what happens across such a shock. So if a shock, say a shock over here, goes after a small time step, the shock might be located a bit further. So in front of the shock, you have your Conant saturation, and behind the shock, you have your SW minus. Well, suppose our shock is located at x0 at time t naught and at x0 plus delta x delta t later. Then the shock moves a bit ahead, but in the full region behind the shock, saturation is more or less the saturation SW minus. Now, and in front of shock, saturation everywhere SW plus. So not only just behind the shock, but in the and this entire region, we approximate the saturation by SW minus. Now, then about velocities. Behind the shock, we take UW minus, and in front of the shock, we call the volumetric velocity UW plus. Furthermore, well, for the picture, I made it 2D, so I put a width of H over here. Well, we have basically 1D profile, so we have it's symmetric in the H direction, but that's just to make the picture. So let's take a look at mass conservation. So what's the amount of mass flowing in this region between x0 and x0 plus delta x? Well, we have a volume of h times delta x, or an area. So how much mass did we add? Well, the saturation above minus the saturation below, so SW minus minus SWX, that's the amount we added, times the room we have to add something times porosity phi. So that's the amount of mass added. Now, how do we add mass? Via inflow minus outflow. So how much did flow in? Well, inflow minus outflow times the time interval delta t times again the width h. Now, if we balance those two, we get the what is added equals the inflow. We see we can cancel out the factor h, of course. And then we find delta x over delta t here by dividing by SW minus minus SW plus over here and dividing by phi. And take the limit delta t to zero. That gives us the shock velocity. And this condition is called the Rankine-Hogonio condition, using also that U minus and U double and U W plus are given by U inject times F W, gives the shock velocity U inject times the jump in F W's, and this yields your shock velocity in terms of S W behind the front and S W in front of the front, because F is given in terms of S W and U inject and phi are constant. So now once you know your saturations in front and behind the front, then you know your shock velocity given by the Rankine-Hogonio condition.